So this is what's still on the board is what I was talking about at the end last time. Maybe it's not that important, but I think it's a good segue into what I'm going to talk about today. So I'm going to go back to it briefly. And so basically what I was saying is that if you think the difference between science and what's not science, that is the answer to what Popper's calling the demarcation problem, is going to be in terms of concepts. So we want to make sure that science is using legitimate empirical concepts. Then you can't also think the difference between science and what's not science is that science uses falsifiable statements, because these two statements have exactly the same concepts in them, but this one is falsifiable and this one is not. On the other hand, if you think that science proceeds by justification of theories rather than falsification of theories, then you can think that what characterizes science is a specific set of concepts that it uses, because this is justifiable by evidence, or I guess I'll say, if this is justifiable by evidence, then this definitely is justifiable by evidence, right? Because any evidence at all will justify this second one, right? Something that is logically valid or logically true or tautological is implied by anything. So any evidence, right, like, you know, if I say, this pen is black, I can infer from that that all swans are white or not white. Because I can infer this from nothing at all, so I can infer it from whatever I want. I can infer it from this pen is blue also, even though it's not blue. Doesn't matter. Right. So, that's the point I was trying to make at the end last time when I got a little bit confused, but that the difference between Carnap and Popper about whether it's a special set of concepts or a special kind of concepts or a special kind of statements that characterizes science goes along with the difference between falsificationism and justificationism. Or, I guess, to put it differently, because Carnap is a falsificationist, he wants to say it doesn't matter which concepts you use. What matters is what kind of statements you use your concepts in, not which concepts you use. Okay, so that's just what I was trying to say at the end last, and we'll see something related to that. We'll come back today. But now I'm going to start talking about the... This has happened to me before. I just erased the board, but this... Yeah. So that also means when I was pointing to the different statements, you didn't see what I was pointing to, probably. Oh, well. Oops. There we go. Okay. So what I want to talk about is the subject of today's reading, chapter 3, which is theories. So we've already seen the word theory used in two different ways, right? One is... theory versus practice, right? Where a theoretical question is a question about what is true and what is false, or what is the case about the world, or something like that. Whereas a practical question is a question about what should we do. That's one use of theory. A second use of theory is... theory versus observation, right? Where a theory means, something you assert or think or whatever that isn't directly about things you can observe, but somehow goes beyond them or something like that. These two uses are both ancient, actually, although... this one is the predominant traditional use that, is found in Aristotle and Kant. However, and I'm only going into this at all because otherwise I think it might be confusing. Popper is not using theory here in either of these senses. the sense he's using it in is maybe like somewhat related to this second sense, but it really doesn't go exactly with that at all. And I'm just gonna write, so it's not this one and it's not this one. And what it is a theory is system of universal statements. It's a system of universal statements about something. I think at least at this stage, Popper doesn't think he needs to or even can add that last part about something. But it's some kind of system of universal statements. So when Popper says at the beginning of chapter 3 that empirical sciences are systems of theories and the logic of scientific knowledge, that is the methodology of science, what we're doing in this book, is, quote, a theory of theories. He means, maybe I should show that in the document camera. This is the very beginning of chapter 3 on page 37. The empirical sciences are systems of theories. The logic of scientific knowledge can therefore be described as a theory of theories. Right? So when he says that, what he means is that the empirical sciences are systems of universal statements. And methodology is a system of universal statements about systems of universal statements, or methodology of science is a system of universal statement, or methodology of empirical science, let me say, is a system of universal statements about systems of universal empirical statements, or something like that. So again, methodology is in some sense a science, even though it's not an empirical science. Remember, I was emphasizing last time that Popper disagrees with Carnap and the other logical positivists who, you know, when they say, well, everything that's not scientific is meaningless, is metaphysical. Popper says, well, first of all, he doesn't think metaphysics is meaningless, but anyway, methodology, which is not metaphysics, is also not meaningless, and it's all, and not only that, but it's a kind of science or doctrine. However, the universal statements of methodology, the universal statements of methodology are, I mean, I guess they are statements, but yet the force of them is that they're conventions or proposed conventions. So, in other words, the theory that the theory of theories that Popper is discussing in this chapter is not theoretical in this sense. It's not theoretical, it's practical, right? It's proposals about what kind of theories, empirical theories, we should have. And as for this sense, well, it's neither theoretical nor observational. That is, because it's not, doesn't consist of statements of facts at all, observable or not. But it is a theory in this sense. Okay, so, are there questions about that so far? Okay, so the word system here is important. It's not, or at least, I mean, it has content to it. It's not just a synonym for set or something like that. In other words, a theory, as Popper understands it, is not just a bunch of universal statements. It's a system of universal statements. And what that means, I think you can tell, actually, by comparing what he says in this chapter about empirical theories and what structure we want for them, to what he said in the last chapter when he was trying to defend the idea that methodology is itself a science or doctrine. Because what he said in the last chapter when he was trying to defend that was that the conventions or proposed conventions that come up in methodology form a systematic whole, because some of them are higher level conventions and others are consequences, lower level consequences of those higher level conventions. So like at the top is of methodology is a convention or proposed way of acting or thinking that says, you know, try to test your theories. Don't try to defend them. And then all the other methodological principles, like you should use theories that are falsifiable, you should do X, Y, and Z with definitions and so forth, are all like consequences of that higher level proposal. And that's exactly analogous to what he's going to say in this chapter about the structure, or at least the structure we hope for in scientific theories. Namely, again, we hope for some highest level universal statements, and those are what he's going to call the axioms of the theory. And then we're going to derive lower level universal statements from those. So that's what makes it systematic. And why is it good that it's, if it's systematic? Well, so we don't know exactly what the answer to that in the case of methodology is, but in the case of empirical scientific theories, he's going to say that it's good that it's systematic, because when, if something gets falsified, you can localize the problem. You can say, well, which axioms are responsible for this by way of what assumptions and whatever, and that helps you understand what choices you have in terms of giving up your all of your theory, giving up part of your theory, or accommodating the event to your theory. Right. Not sure what to say about whether the reason we want systematicity in methodology I think it's analogous, but not because falsification is still an issue in this case, but because responsibility for every part of the methodology is still at issue in this case. And so you want to be able to understand why you're supposed to accept a certain methodological principle. All right. So that's what is meant by theory here in general. And by empirical scientific theory in particular, then, is just meant a system of universal statements, which is usable for the purposes of empirical science. So what kind of universal statements are those? So, Popper's answer to that is that the universal statements of an empirical scientific theory are supposed to be the kind that can figure in, that can be used for the purpose of causal explanations. Now, what does that mean exactly? What is a causal explanation? Oops. What is a causal explanation? So, Popper wants to get away from thinking that a causal explanation is when you have an event B, which is going to be the effect,
and you want to supply an event A, which is going to be the cause of the event B.
Let alone, I guess, an even older way of thinking about causation, which is that you have a thing, B, and you want to find the thing, A, that is the cause of B. He wants to get away from this way of thinking about it. Why? Well, because in general, like, modern science doesn't contain explanations like that. In order to know what's going to happen next, right? So the idea would be that if you knew this event happened at one time, then you could deduce from that that this other event is going to happen later. Typically, if you look at two different times, you can't give one feature of the first time that makes it possible to predict a single feature of the later time. Right? So, you know, like, if I... let go of this pen, and then later it hits the floor, you can't say whether the cause of it hitting the floor was that I let go of the pen or that the mass of the earth was there. Without either of those things, it wouldn't have hit the floor. And there's a lot of other things that you could have changed at the initial time such that it wouldn't have hit the floor. You know, like, the floor could have been moving that way. Instead, Popper wants to understand a causal explanation like this. A causal explanation means that from one, some universal law, and two, actually, I guess in your text it calls these initial conditions. We can infer that a certain event will take place. Initial conditions. Now, I mean, again, like, it's a little weird to criticize the translation here because it's Popper's translation. As I said, I don't know how closely he supervised it and how much of it was done by those other people who are given, like, kind of secondary credit. But, you know, presumably he had some reason for doing this. But actually, in German, what it says is not initial conditions, but boundary conditions. Now, I mean, these are both perfectly good, like, pieces of scientific terminology to put in there. Boundary conditions is just more general. I don't know why, in translating it, he wanted to restrict it to initial conditions. So, like... initial conditions keeps it closer to the idea that the cause is something particular about an earlier state of things that allows us, using the universal law, to predict the later state of things. So an example of this, so like if the universal law were, something like, right, this is the law of how things move vertically in a uniform gravitational field. The change of velocity with respect to time is a constant. Minus g, it's a negative constant, meaning like we're treating the direction things are accelerating due to gravity as negative, like down, right? So from this we, you know, can't predict what from this by itself, you can't predict what position something will be in at a certain time. It just says how its velocity will change. So how do you know where it's going to be or how fast it's going to be going? But if you say, well, at t zero, it was at a certain height, h zero, h naught, pronounce that. It was at a certain height, h naught, and it was going at a velocity v naught, a vertical velocity v naught. Then, if you ask me where it is at any given time, I can say, well, its height at a given time, say its height at t1 is h naught plus v naught t1 minus 1/2 g t naught squared. Right? So these are the initial conditions, and you can see why they're called initial conditions, because I told you, you know, where it was and how fast it was going at the beginning. And given those initial conditions plus this universal law, I can tell you where it's expected to be at any particular time. And then, you know, we can check to see if it's there. But and Popper says you can call the initial conditions the cause, right? So we can say our causal explanation is that given this cause, that it was at a certain place going in a certain velocity, whatever, universal laws imply this effect or something like that. But the truth is that I don't necessarily have to give you initial conditions. I can tell you something about where it's going to be at the end, and you can still solve to figure out all of this. Or to give a better example, you know, if we have some universal law of how strings behave when they're when part of them is moved away from the rest. And then I tell you that I have a string where both ends are fixed. And I tell you how fast it's moving to begin with. This point on the string, you know, should have worked out this example better.
Right. So I tell you, I guess I have to tell you where, I still have to give you a lot of initial conditions, where the string was and how fast each part of it was moving at the beginning. And then with the additional knowledge that these two parts
not only weren't moving at the beginning, but they can't move, they're stuck, then you can solve to see, you know, what the string will do as time goes on. But, so that's why these are called boundary conditions, because I tell you what the string is doing at the end. And all of these are just special cases of whatever kind of particular information I have to give you in order to apply the universal law. So, you know, in Popper uses an example of a weight that's attached to the string, and we want to know whether our laws imply that the string will break. And the initial conditions or boundary conditions that he discusses are how big the weight is and what kind of stuff the string is made out of, or how strong the material the string is made out of. So, I mean, those aren't really like the way it was to begin or the way it is at the boundary, but they're part of what he's calling initial conditions or boundary conditions. Okay, so someone said at some point the floor attracted the pen. Not sure what that was a comment on. I should pay more attention to the chat, but I'm kind of busy. But yeah, that's what I meant when I said that, like, part of the initial conditions. So if all I tell you are, you know, the laws of Newtonian mechanics, of course, Newtonian mechanics isn't correct, but assume it is. Philosophers say that all too often, like as if we actually know what it would be like if Newtonian mechanics were correct. But of course, like, we don't know at all what it would be like. Like, we don't know why the sun would shine, for example, if Newtonian mechanics were correct. Never mind that. So assume Newtonian mechanics is correct. So given all the laws of Newtonian mechanics, I asked you, where will this pen be at time t? You can't say, right? I have to tell you where the pen was at a certain time, and I have to tell you something about the mass distribution around the pen at that time. In fact, in Newtonian mechanics, in principle, I have to tell you something about the mass distribution everywhere at that time. In general relativity, the amount of mass distribution or mass stress energy distribution that I have to tell you about is like gets smaller and smaller the closer I get to where I'm asking about the pen. But so in Newtonian mechanics, anyway, it's not enough for me to tell you at time t0 whether my hand was under the pen or not. I have to tell you all about where all the masses and any other sources of forces on the pen were at t0 and what they did later. So there's a lot of initial and boundary conditions. And then if I plug all of those in and call those the cause, I can say, and that cause, which turns out to be like all the information about everything in the universe that is relevant to this, given those universal laws, implies the pen will be here. Okay. I don't know. Maybe Alvaro, maybe what you meant was when you, like, or there could be some other reason the floor attracted the pen. besides gravity. but if that means there could be another kind of universal force besides gravity, then that wouldn't be a matter of the initial conditions or the boundary conditions. That would be a matter of proposing a different theory. Okay, so I don't know if that addresses that remark or not, but okay, so I'm going to go on and talk about why we want our theories to consist of these causal explanations. I mean, in some sense, it's pretty easy to see, but then we'll see there's complications about that. Before I do that, I want to say something about the principle of causality. Because Popper discusses that here, and I mean, he discusses that here mostly just to say, like, don't get distracted by it. In fact, I think, is this the first thing he says about it? But anyway, he says right away, basically, I'm not going to be proposing a principle of causality, and I don't need a principle of causality, right? Well, what would a principle of causality be? Well, a principle of causality would tell you that that there's a causal explanation for every event. Right? So again, the causal explanation is the universal law plus the initial conditions. The principle of causality would tell you that every event has a cause. This is what Kant calls, well, but does he mean the same thing by cause? Anyway, Popper thinks that this is the same thing that Kant is talking about in the second analogy in the Critique of Pure Reason, where it basically is the principle that every event has a cause. It's just the question is whether he means the same thing by cause. But anyway, a principle of causality would be a principle that guarantees you that when you see an event, you can find an explanation like that. Now, I mean, meaning, of course, you can find a true explanation like that. Because obviously, but this will turn out to be part of the problem with a principle of causality. You can obviously find a possible explanation like that. Right? That is, you can obviously find some kind of universal statement. In fact, if you don't restrict what the universal statement can be like, you can find one that you don't even need initial conditions. Your universal statement can be something like, this event always happens everywhere. Right? That would be a causal explanation of your event. It's just not true. This event doesn't always happen everywhere. There is no event like that, I guess. So, but anyway, it's certainly most events that we're interested in are not like that. So that causal explanation would be bad. The question is, can you always find a universal law that really is universally true, such that certain initial conditions that really do hold, together with that universal law, imply this event? The problem with the principle of causality Can you hear someone talking besides me in the background? Okay, hold on a second.
I'm sorry, but could you be a little bit quieter? Yeah. Just, yeah, if you could be a little bit quieter because my students can hear you. Yeah.
Okay, sorry. It's hard. Everyone in the house is on a Zoom call right now. So the problem with a principle of causality like that, from Popper's point of view, will be because there's an infinite number of possible causal explanations, the principle of causality itself is not falsifiable. Right? That is, if I find an event, so a falsification would consist in finding an event, but there being no true causal explanation for it. But I have an infinite number of possible causal explanations to check. So to speak, I'm never going to get to all of them, or another way of putting it would be no finite number of events is ever going to be enough to falsify all of them. So the principle of causality itself is unfalsifiable. And what kind of principle is it? Well, it's a metaphysical principle. And sure enough, Kant, again, in what at least Popper assumes is a treatment of this exact same question. Kant says that this principle is synthetic a priori. Right? Remember that Popper said, like, you know, if we could have synthetic a priori principles, then we could have metaphysical principles, non-falsifiable principles that we're still sure are true because they're not empirical and they're not tautological, but they're synthetic a priori. So that seems to fit together. Now, I mean, the question in my mind, and that's really why I think it's worth going into this discussion at all, because like I said, from Popper's point of view, at least officially, it seems like the discussion of the principle of causality here is really just trying to get rid of a distraction. Right? He's saying, oh, you know, theories consist of causal explanations, and right away philosophers who are interested, you know, who have gotten used to this question about the principle of causality are going to be like, oh, what guarantees that there are causal explanations? So Popper says, well, I don't know if anything guarantees it. That would be metaphysical. I'm not going to talk about that. But the question is, in my mind, is when he says, I'm not going to discuss this because it would be metaphysical, what does he mean by that? So, I mean, especially given what he says instead, he says, well, I am going to say something here that you might think is quite a bit like a principle of causality, only it's also not empirical. It's also not falsifiable. But it's not metaphysical. What is it? Well, it's methodological. Right? So remember, again, we had like if we thought the choices were analytic, empirical, synthetic a priori, Popper adds, or it could be practical and not theoretical at all. That is, it could be a matter of methodology. What should you do? And Popper says, so instead of this metaphysical principle of causality, I'm going to offer this methodological principle that you should look for theories that consist of causal explanations. And you should always keep looking for them. Never give up. So you're acting as if you had a guarantee that you would find one. so to speak. And that's why he says it's a lot like this metaphysical principle. But unlike this metaphysical principle, it doesn't say something non-falsifiable is true or false. It just tells you what to do. Now, I mean, there's a couple of questions about this. One, if I were really going to go into what's the real relationship between Popper and Kant, I would have to point out that Kant himself says something very similar in the Transcendental Dialectic, which again raises a worry about whether they really are talking about the same thing when they argue about the principle of causality. But be that as it may, just staying with Popper, the question is, when he says, well, this principle will be metaphysical, so instead I'm going to offer this other thing that's methodological, does he just mean, because I'm doing methodology here and not metaphysics? So that, I mean, that would make sense, but it doesn't sound like what he's saying. Like, it doesn't sound like in that place he means... And the metaphysical question can be decided by metaphysicians at their leisure or something like that. It sounds like he means more like what Carnap would say at this point. Since it's metaphysical, there's no way of deciding it or something like that, so it'd be a waste of time to discuss it. I think that just points out that there's some ambiguity in this book as far as Popper's attitude towards metaphysics, theoretical metaphysics. Sometimes he says, well, I have nothing against it, it's just not empirical science. But other times he seems to be leaning more towards the logical positivist view that it's really a waste of time to engage with it. And I think later he settled things more on the first alternative. And you see it, therefore you'll see the first alternative more in those new footnotes with the asterisks. But at this time, for various reasons, he was not, or I guess I should say he settled that later for various reasons, but at this time he hadn't settled it. Okay. Are there questions about this so far? By the way, I guess maybe I should have said this at the beginning, and also maybe it's not that important, because as usual, there's not that many people here, but I got an email, I guess I got it yesterday, but I only saw it today, saying that someone came to my office hour yesterday and they couldn't get through. Does anyone else have that? Did anyone who's here have that experience? Because I was sitting on Zoom with what I thought was the office hour link open for the whole hour, and no one came, but now I'm worried that maybe there's something wrong with the link somewhere or something. I know it's not systematic, because I know people have been coming to my office hours. Okay, well, if no one who's here tried that, we don't know. Anyway, So why do we want this kind of theory? That is, remember, the theory is this part, the universal law, right? Because by definition of theory, in this sense of theory, a theory is a system of universal statements. So the theory is going to be this part. Why do we want the kind of universal statement that, when combined with initial conditions, can allow us to infer that a certain event will take place, or is now taking place, or has already taken place? And the answer is, one way of putting the answer would be, This is the kind of theory that makes empirical predictions. Where, again, based on what I was just saying, prediction could be used kind of broadly. I mean, this is the same move we saw in Goodman. I don't think Carnap would disagree with it. Prediction, oftentimes what you're predicting is an event that already happened in the past. Or you're predicting what you see right in front of you, meaning that you're not really predicting it, you're explaining it. Right? I think that's why Popper uses the term causal explanations. This is the type of theory that can predict or explain events, empirical events. More broadly speaking, particular, like singular empirical statements. But Popper says, and this is in is explicit only in a new footnote on page 40, but it seems to me like, and I think you can see it from elsewhere in the text, that this is what he always thought all along, that what he calls the theoretician, I should see what that is in German. So those new footnotes and stuff were first published in English, but the latest German edition also has them in German, and I seem to recall him saying somewhere that he wrote them in German and translated them into English. So there is still an original. But okay, in any case, the theoretician, Popper says, is not interested in predictions as such, right? As opposed to who? So like here, theoretician, we're talking about theory versus practice, I guess. The theoretician is someone who just wants to know what's true or not. What is the right theory or not? So the theoretician is as opposed to the practical person who's trying to apply the theory to decide what to do. Obviously, they really care about predictions, and predictions in the narrow sense of what's going to happen in the future. But Popper says that's not why the theoretician is interested in predictions. Why is the theoretician interested in predictions and, more broadly speaking, explanations? Well, obviously because making this kind of prediction or giving this kind of explanation is what the theory has to do in order to be falsifiable. If I have a universal statement that I can't use this way, then no singular event is ever going to contradict it. There's lots of examples of universal statements like that can't be used this way, you know, like, for all X, if X is a swan, then X is either white or not white. No matter what singular statements I plug into that, it doesn't imply any other singular statements. Or if you allow to count as universal statements negative universal statements, like not for all X. If X is a swan, then X is white, which just means there's some swan that isn't white. This is not falsifiable. And again, it's because no matter what initial conditions I plug in, It doesn't imply any singular statements. At least, assuming we can't run out of swans. So, I mean, I'll come back to that. As Popper comes back to that, I'll come back to that at the end of the lecture. But assuming that there are, you know, always more swans to be checked, then no matter how many singular statements I supply, and what kind of singular statements would be relevant? That is, what could you even try as initial conditions or boundary conditions here? Well, you know, you could say, this swan is white. This swan is white, and this swan is white, and this swan is white. Therefore, you want to conclude this swan is not white, and then you can check, right? But no matter how many swans are you find that are white, you still never can use this to conclude that any other particular swan is not white. Now, of course, if you supply as your initial conditions, this swan is not white, then you know this is true, but you didn't derive that from this with the help of your initial conditions. Your initial condition, right, you know this is true, but if we were interested in his justification rather than falsification, then you would say, oh yeah, I can justify this theory. Just go out and the first swan I see that's not white, this theory now has evidence in its favor. In fact, it now has been proved to be true. Right? So from a justificational point of view, this looks like maybe it would be a good kind of theory. It's a kind of theory you can confirm with one piece of evidence. You don't have to search anymore after you find the first swan that's not white. But if you're looking to falsify theories, then that case of... finding a swan that's not white obviously doesn't falsify the theory. To falsify the theory, you want to find a swan that is white that the theory says shouldn't be, and you can't because the theory doesn't say that any specific swan is not white. I feel like I gave a more complicated explanation of that than it deserved. Is it clear why this is not falsifiable? Meaning, again, it doesn't imply any singular statements, even if I supply others, as many as I want, as initial conditions. I still can't crank out any particular statement out of this. I guess, you know, I should have said the simplest way of understanding is the thing I only said at the end. Because this doesn't say that this says something about swans not being white, but it doesn't say that any particular swan is not white. And no matter how much information I plug in about the world, as long as there's still lots of swans left, as long as there always will be more swans left, this one will just keep saying, well, at least one of them's not white, but it won't tell you anything about any particular one you're about to check. Okay, so that's another example of a theory that consists of a universal statement, but not the kind that could be a causal explanation. So getting back to what I said to begin with, we want theories like this that are causal explanations, because those are the ones that could be falsified. So, for example, how can they be falsified? Like, what does this process look like? Well, so here's an example of a simple type of universal law. And, right, we could read this as saying, all p's are q. Right, for all x, if x is a p, then x is a q. So it says all p's are q. It's more or less one of the traditional types of judgment in Aristotelian logic, more or less. If we have a law like this, then I plug in this initial condition. And from that, I can conclude this event, or at least this singular occurrence, this singular statement, this particular thing, A, is a Q, right? Because my initial condition is that it's a P, and the law says that all P's are Q's, so I have a causal explanation as for why A is Q, namely because it's P. And it's because the theory looks like this that it needs the initial condition. Why not have a theory like this? Everything is Q. In that case, without any initial conditions, I can, conclude that this is true, whatever A is, because my theory says that everything is Q, so whatever A is, it's Q. Therefore, this theory is falsifiable without supplying initial conditions or boundary conditions, right? It's very easy to falsify, in a sense. All I have to do is find anything that's not Q, and the theory is falsified. Why not, since what we're after is falsifiability, why not adopt this kind of theory, which I guess you could also call it a causal explanation, only it's a causal explanation that doesn't involve what Popper is calling the cause, right? Remember, Popper said if you want to call something the cause, you should call the initial conditions the cause. The cause is the state of affairs such that, given the laws, the thing you're explaining follows. So in this case, there is no cause. In other words, it's a necessary truth that A is Q. It follows just from the laws of nature that A is Q. That seems like that would be a better kind of theory. So I think the answer is just that. Well, okay, so I know the answer is this. The question is whether there's more to say about it than this. The answer is we don't have theories like that. right? Everything is white. I guess the question is whether there's more to say from Popper, and there certainly is something more to say, but the question is what more there is to say from Popper's point of view about why we don't have theories like that. Hume, I guess it's Hume. Is it Hume or Berkeley? One of them at some point, you know, describes a situation where the only thing I've ever seen is purple dots, and, you know, says, well, I wouldn't be able to abstract the color. So my concept of space would be concept of purple space. or maybe you should say we would call the person's concept of space in that situation the concept of purple space, but they couldn't say it because they couldn't form the abstract concept purple. In other words, it seems like it's not just a unfortunate contingency that we don't have theories like this, but rather that we couldn't have theories like this. But I don't know of anywhere where Popper explains from his point of view exactly why that is. Now, of course, when I said that, when I say we don't have theories like this, I have to be making some kind of assumption about what Q is like. Like, if we said, you know, and the no reason I can't do this, apparently, I'm going to define A to mean I'm going to say something is A if it's true of that thing that if it's a P, then it's a Q. Which, you know, given the way this symbol is interpreted in modern mathematical logic, what that means is that something is an A if it's either, that's right, something is an A if it's not a P and not a Q, or in other words, if it's either a Q or not a P, right? So, like, in other words, if P was swan and Q was white, then this would say, you know, if this thing is a swan, it's white. Or in other words, this would say that it's either white or it's not a swan. And this, I hope you might have some memory from Phil 9, that, you know, that to say this is the same as saying that. Just to make sure the order of operations is clear there. Right, and the only reason I went into that explanation of how it's equivalent to that statement with or is that if you didn't realize that, you might think, wait, this isn't something you can say about something. If it's P, then it's Q. That's like a little prediction about it or something. But actually, and there's a footnote about this in Popper, you know, about that Tarski was the one who called his attention to the difference between material implication and rules of inference. Without going into what the issue is there, I'll just say, you know, that as this kind of implication is understood in the type of logic that Popper and Carnap are both using, this is something you can say about something. You're saying that it's either Q or it's not P. And if you want, you can define A to mean that. And then if you say for all X, everything is in A,
And then you supply an initial condition. Maybe I shouldn't have used A. It's called R. You supply the initial condition, A is a P. Then given what R means, we can conclude that A is a Q, right?
So again, because in this case with the white and swan example, to say that something is R would be to say that it's either white or it's not a swan.
And then I say, well, this thing, A, is a swan.
Now we know it has to be white.
So what this shows is
that the whole idea of a theory consisting of causal explanations, of which, you know, this is the simplest, let me go back to the whole thing.
This is the simplest kind of causal explanation, right? One that only requires one initial condition, so to speak,
and that only makes one prediction. You can't tell if the theory is of this form just by looking to see if it's written this way.
You have to know whether P
and Q are the right kind of predicates. Similarly, if I define P as either a swan or not a swan, in that case, you know, I can say universal law. If something is either a swan or not a swan, then it's white. But that really just means everything's white. Right? So again, even though we were wrote it this way, it turned out to really be this kind of theory. This kind of theory, right? It really just says everything's white. Doesn't matter if it's a swan or not. So
again, if you want to check whether your theory is like this,
you have to know what the letters mean. You have to know that they're the right kind of predicates. Okay. So again, the reason we want causal explanations is that
the reason we want this kind of theory, or I mean, the reason we want causal explanations,
and causal explanations are the type of theory which, if the predicates are the right kind of predicates, they can be written. Sorry, I'm pissing at it. If the predicates are the right kind of predicates, they can be written this way. But what we care about is not whether they're written this way or some other way, but that you can use them to do this. And the reason we want that is because we want theories you can use to do this, because using it to do this means you can falsify it. And again, you can falsify it because when you predict or explain this, but it turns out that's not what happened or is not or doesn't happen eventually, then the theory is falsified. Okay. It's for a similar methodological reason that we want our theories to be systems of statements like this. So this is something Popper addresses on page 50. Why do we want a whole system? You know, what I said before about this wasn't exactly right. Or maybe it wasn't the most important reason. Now I have to think again whether it's analogous to methodology or not, but let me not get bogged down in that. This is the explanation. This is very necessary, for a severe test of a system presupposes that it is at the time sufficiently definite and final in form. Okay, I do think it's the same issue, but it's a little more complicated than I thought. So what we need is a system that can be well surveyed as a whole with all its important consequences. So that, again, is a reason why you want something like an axiomatization. You want higher level principles from which all the consequences can be deduced, and you can follow how they are deduced from it. But he's not giving the reason I gave for it. I think he gives that farther on in this section, but at this point, the reason he's giving for it is that you want to be able to say for sure what the theory is and what it isn't. So if the theory just consists of like a huge set of different unrelated universal statements, then it's hard to be sure which statements really belong to the theory and which don't. And therefore, it's hard to falsify it because, when you supply some apparently falsifying instance, someone else can come along and say, well, no, actually that, law by itself wasn't part of the system, but only under certain conditions or something like that. And for that purpose, in order to like be able to know for sure what's in and what's out, it's important to have a small number of universal statements that you can identify with the theory, and then everything else that's part of the theory will be a consequence of those. So you can keep in mind what all the, you can keep in mind what kind of things are going to belong to the theory and what kinds are not without having to remember every single one. Okay, so, and Popper says that, we don't in real life, our theories are not usually at that stage. We don't have some higher level principles that, I mean, you have to understand what the situation is here. Like, we don't have some higher level principles that we're sure, such that we're sure that all the consequences of the theory follow from those, and there aren't additional assumptions. So what does it mean? Like, what are we unsure about there? What we're unsure about is our own confidence or will as to how to use these universal statements, I think. We're not sure when the time comes whether we're going to be willing to count the consequences of just these statements as the consequences of our theory, or if we don't really mean something else a little bit different as the theory. So again, like it's a methodological ideal. It would be good if we had theories that, where we can be confident what we mean by the theory. But As for what it would take to have theories like that, that's a matter of like, that's a question of like how to get an idea that I really want to stand behind, which is similar to the question of how to get an idea in the first place, how to get any universal statement that I want, that I feel like proposing to be tested. And Popper says, that's, you know, not my topic here. And furthermore, I at least suspect that there's nothing useful to be said about it, that it's just psychology. Why is that not useful? There's nothing practically helpful to be said about it. Here's what to do if you want to gain this kind of confidence. Okay, so anyway, we don't have theories that are that systematized, but we have something close to it most of the time, and that's why if we act correctly, we can test them. Okay, so again, the system is going to look like there are the axioms, and then there are consequences we derive from the axioms. And, you know, what we want is for the axioms to be few and the consequences to be many. Now, but this is all within the theory. So these consequences themselves are all universal statements. Now, Popper says that these are the highest universal statements. I mean, what does that mean? It's not like they're more universal than the other universal statements. It's either universal or it isn't. But I think what it means is that here's how to put it. So why do we keep drawing out these consequences? Why not just have a few axioms and that's our theory? Well, the answer is because typically, not only don't the axioms, maybe I shouldn't say that, but typically it's not clear how to supply initial conditions to get singular predictions out of the axioms by themselves. To get to the point where it's clear what kind of initial conditions we need to supply, we need to derive lots of consequences from the axioms. And at the end, you'll get something like this, where P and Q are things that you can check by observation. So these are highest in the sense that the deduction starts with these, and they're in some sense the most universal or highest universal because they're the ones that are farthest away from the point where we're actually going to supply the initial condition or the boundary condition. And again, that's just because the whole purpose of cranking out consequences is to get to this point. When we get to this point, we stop. So where the place we start is going to be farthest away from where we stop. All right, so that's what the doctrinal side of the system looks like. However, remember, Popper agrees with Carnap. There's not only a doctrinal question. They're not only doctrinal questions. There are also conceptual questions. So, actually, let me erase most of this here.
this is the doctrinal side, or what Carnap would call the deductive system, and this is the conceptual side, or what Carnap would call the constructional system. Right?
So, and Popper says,
These terms are defined in terms of these, which are defined in terms of these, and eventually we get back to undefined terms.
Now, why do we get back to undefined terms eventually? Like, you might think we would get back to pointing at things. Ostensive definition, as it's sometimes called. Right? So at the bottom of all our definitions would be, you know, I would say, you would ask me, what's a P? And I would say, well, a P is a Q that S's. And you would say, well, okay, well, what's a Q and what's an S? Well, I'd say, well, a Q is a T that U's. I'm running out of letters here. But I would say, well, a T is a V that U's and an S is a W that Y's, or, you know, so on and so forth. And you would keep asking me and keep asking me, but eventually you might think I would get to a point where you would say, okay, and what's a W? And I would say, this is a W. But Popper says, remember, we're talking about a system of universal statements, so that the predicates involved in them are all universal predicates. Like, right, like, so that's why I imagined you asking, what's a W? And I say, this is a W. Now, but this is a W doesn't provide a definition of W if W is a universal term. It just gives you an example. You still don't know what other things might be W and what other things are not W. So if, as long as we're talking about universal terms, you can't get down to an ostensive definition. And Popper makes this case at great length. So rather, the place where I say, and this is a W, is going to come at the bottom. These terms are undefined. These terms are defined in terms of these terms. These terms are defined in terms of these terms. At the bottom, I'm going to get a term that says, you know, something is a W if it's a U that V's, if it's a U and a V. And then you're going to ask me, what's a U and what's... Sorry, so these, you're not going to ask me what is, because those questions, like what is a U and what is a V, are answered by going up to my undefined terms at the top.
When I get down all this way down to the bottom, I'm going to say, oh, and by the way, here's a W. And that's what's going to allow me down here. This is going to be the initial condition that allows me to get predictions out of the doctrinal side.
So again, the two sides are analogous to each other, and these undefined terms are, so to speak, the most universal terms. That is, they're the terms that are farthest away from the place where we're going to plug in individual things. And again, it's because, why do we keep doing this? Because we want to get down to the terms that apply to things that are in the consequences, the bottom consequences we're going to test. When we get to those, we stop. So the ones we start with, the undefined terms, are going to be farthest away from these. Okay, I see I'm running out of time here, which means, unfortunately, there's an important thing I'm going to have to talk about next time, which is the issue of strictly universal versus numerically universal. But I'm at least going to try to get through everything else besides that. So, okay, so, but this is weird, right? It's weird because this means my axioms are a bunch of statements containing all undefined terms. So why do they mean anything? Or how do we know what they mean? Or something like that. So Popper says, well, here's one way. I can say these things get their meaning from their use in the axioms. The axioms are quote-unquote implicit definitions of these things. So how would that work? I mean, there's problems with getting that to work, but roughly speaking, the idea is that I would say, well, I'm going to get consequences from these axioms. Since I know the axioms are true, I know the consequences have to be true. Part of the problem is going to be like the issue about the initial conditions. But so basically, like somehow from these bottom level universal consequences, I'm going to get some particular statements. Since the axioms are true, I know those singular particular statements are true. And so I know that some things like this are true. And so I just ask, well, what would W have to mean to make this true? And then from that, I figure out what U and V would have to mean. And then from that, blah, 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 blah. And in the end, I get back to what these terms would have to mean to make this true. But this means that the axioms would be unfalsifiable. This is what Popper calls conventionalism. Because it amounts to the axioms being like a proposal for what to say. And then we'll figure out what the terms have to mean to make it true. So we're always going to say it. We're never going to give it up. But what we're going to do is adjust the definition of our terms until it's true, no matter what evidence we take in. Obviously, Popper is not going to suggest that method. but I see I don't have time even to finish discussing this today, so I'm afraid I'm going to have to put both of these things up to next time and deal with that as best I can. So the two things I'm putting off are basically, well, number one, maybe a slightly less rushed explanation of what conventionalism is, but number two, what Popper thinks is the alternative to conventionalism. Where do our undefined terms get their meaning, if not in this conventionalist way? And number two, the thing I didn't discuss yet at all, the question of the difference between strictly universal statements, which are the kind we want in our theory, and merely numerically universal statements. So I'm going to have to talk about both of those on Thursday, and I'll see you then. Bye.